On this special Sunday in the church, we remember Jesus' baptism, and we will ordain and install our new church officers, elders, and deacons. We did so at the first service, and we have a few more at the second service. And so for those of you who are being ordained and installed, we have a few gifts. Normally, part of that ordination service is to lay hands on people, and we aren't going to do that today because it's not very COVID kosher. So I have stoles for the elders, and I have prayer shawls for the deacons that you can take with you and then extend in a blessing to someone else. But that's the way that we're going to virtually lay our hands on you in that prayer of blessing and connection. But as we remember Jesus' baptism, I encourage you to remember your own baptism. That God, who created the heavens and the earth and the waters over the seas, is with us. That God gives us life in his very presence, that we need water to survive, that it washes us clean, that it gives us that connection to one another and to the Holy Spirit. So let's give careful listening this morning to our scripture from Matthew chapter 3. In those days, John the Baptist came, preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the desert, "Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all of Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And don't think you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the trees, and every tree that doesn't produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me will come one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I'm not even worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering the wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire." Then Jesus came from Galilee to the Jordan to be baptized by John. But John tried to deter him, saying, "No, no, I need to be baptized by you, and you're coming to me?" Jesus replied, "Let it be so now. It is proper for us to do this, to fulfill all righteousness." And so John consented. As soon as Jesus was baptized, he went up out of the water. And at that moment, heaven opened. And he saw the Spirit of God descending and like a dove and lighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my Son, whom I love. With him I am well pleased." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord God, just as the people heard your voice, we ask that we would have ears to hear, that we too would hear your voice calling us into discipleship, encouraging us with the assurance that we are yours, and that you love us. Amen. As you well know, the events of this past week have been very frightening, and dangerous riots in our nation's Capitol buildings grieve my heart. To see the type of conflict that we have watched take place in our cities, in our social media, and even in our very churches. We have a responsibility to work for justice and righteousness and to speak out against wrong, but we must do these things in ways that live alongside our discipleship to Christ. And I have been criticized for not speaking out against violent protest in the past, but right now I want to say to you, all acts of violent protest are not of God. That when George Floyd and Breonna Taylor were killed and people took to the streets, their desire was to change, to help people to see that they are equal in humanity, that systems needed to change. And so we condemn all acts of violent protest. When Martin Luther King Jr. was encouraging people, it was always about peaceful and nonviolent protest. That he said nothing else is of God. That if we truly are working and ambassadors for God, we have to do it in this way, in this nonviolent and peaceful way. That is who God calls us to be. When we see these problems and this chaos and this conflict in our country, when we see the hurt in the world, we can feel powerless. We can feel as if those problems are far too great and too big for me to do anything. And alone, we cannot stop conflict or protests. We cannot stop riots and chaos. By ourselves, we are powerless. We can't change people's opinions, but together we can stand as brothers and sisters in Christ, united for justice and peace in our nation. Together we can do something. And what does Jesus call us to do? When we ordain and install people, part of the liturgy is this beautiful phrase that we have the incredible gift of being called by God to be Christ's disciples. It says that discipleship is a gift and also a commitment. The discipleship is an offering and a responsibility. And as disciples of Jesus Christ, we are responsible to work on Christ's behalf in the world. We are responsible for lifting up the downtrodden. We are responsible for freeing those trapped in chains. We are responsible for giving love and life to those on the very brink of despair. We have this gift, we have this calling, and this responsibility to care for one another. We also, as Christians, have a responsibility to respect the authorities. That Peter and Paul and even Jesus said, give to Caesar what is Caesar's. That we are called as Christians to be obedient to those in authority. And when we feel as if we are powerless to make change in these huge systems that we see are broken and are wrong, I want to encourage us that we can stand for what is right and what is good. But when Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River, the very first thing that he did after being baptized was not to go and preach a sermon. The very first thing that he did after he was baptized was not to go and heal people or to feed thousands of people. The very first thing he did after he was baptized was not to walk to the cross. It was to go out into the wilderness and pray. That he spends 40 days seeking after God. That he comes and he falls on his knees in the river of Jordan and he receives that blessing of God. And then he seeks out, what is God calling me to be? Because the kingdom that Jesus was going to work towards was not his kingdom. It was God's kingdom. And the kingdom that we are working towards and fighting for is not my kingdom. It is God's kingdom. It is not the kingdom of the United States. We, as disciples of Jesus, are followers of that one King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That is the kingdom we are called to work for. And before we ever take to the streets, God calls us to get on our knees. That we need to pray and seek first his kingdom, and all these things will be added unto you. That we are called in that place of repentance and prayer. It's in that act of submission that God empowers us to do things we couldn't do. It's in that act of being on our knees in faithful prayer that God gives us the gifts and abilities and the opportunities to do stuff we never thought we could accomplish. One of the things that has been ringing through my mind lately is those moments when I feel as if I'm powerless to do anything in this great chaos and difficulty that we see around us. I remember the words of Vivi's little dance teacher. She's this sweet lady, Miss Shauna, and she's got bubbly energy all the time. She makes me tired just looking at her. But one of her favorite phrases is, never say can't. And so when the children are in her dance studio and they're trying to learn something new, if they say, I can't do that, she says, never say can't. It might take longer than you wanted it to. You might not get it on the first try or the second or the 15th. It might take you a long time, but never say that you can't, because you just need to work harder at it. And I think that that's part of what God calls us to as well, that we can with his power, with his blessing, when it is his will. What holds you back, friends, from doing hard things in your life and in the world? Is it a fear of failure? Is it worry that someone else could do it better than we can? Right before Christmas time, the kids and I were watching this silly TV show called Nailed It. And what they do in this show is they bring three bakers in, and they have this professional team of bakers that have created this beautiful creation, cakes and candies and all kinds of beautiful things. And they spent weeks making this stuff. And these amateur, kind of terrible bakers are now expected within this short, you know, hour and a half time frame to recreate the same thing that took somebody else who's a professional weeks and weeks to do. So there's no way they're going to get anywhere close to it. Like, they are going to fail, and it'll be a big hot mess. But it's about how close they can get. You know, and so the kids and I were like, okay, this is a really fun show. We should do our own Nailed It challenge. So Vivi said, I want to make a birthday cake for Paul that looks like Spider-Man. So we look on Pinterest and we found something that was kind of fun, little Spider-Man cake. I said, we could try this one. So she makes her cake. And Paul said, I want to make some Grinch cookies. So we figure out, okay, here's a picture. We can make some Grinch cookies. And I took pictures of them and sent it to friends and things like that. And it was ridiculous, and it tasted pretty good, so that was nice. But it was nowhere near the perfect thing that was on Pinterest. It didn't look anything like theirs. But it was so much fun. And in the process of that, I said, you know what? We totally nailed it. It was great, and it was fun, and we enjoyed this together. And I think that that's what God says to us. When we try to give something to God, his face delights in our effort, in our heart, and in our desire to make something beautiful, to make something wonderful, to make something for the kingdom. That it's not going to be, it's easy for us to step back and say, I can't do enough, and I'm just going to leave that Christian work to the professionals, because they can do it way better than I ever could. And that's not what God calls us to. In discipleship, he calls us to get in there and start doing and working and being the hands and heart of Jesus Christ to one another. And when we totally fail and it's a big hot mess and we say, Lord, I tried. And he says, you know what? You nailed it. That's exactly what I wanted you to do. And his face lights up. I love that the servant that he talks about in Isaiah 42 says, this is my chosen one in whom I delight. That God delights in you, my friends. That God has incredible joy. And we can't do all things perfectly, whether it's because of time constraints or limited resources, but we can do something. And even putting a box of spaghetti in the little blessings pantry might mean the difference between somebody having a meal that day and going hungry. And it doesn't mean we're going to go and feed every person who's hungry, but we could take care of this one because we were faithful with something. One of the other beautiful things that happens in the ordination liturgy is a phrase that says, "The grace bestowed on you in baptism is sufficient for your calling because it is God's grace." And I love the assertion that baptism is all that we need. That's the only qualification you have to have in order to serve God. That God's grace given in baptism qualifies us to be used by God. And Jesus' baptism happens at the beginning of the gospel accounts. How many people has he healed at the time when he goes to the Jordan River? None. How many miracles has he performed? None. How many thousands of people has he fed before he goes to the Jordan River and hears the word of God saying, "This is my son, and I am pleased with him. I love him." He hasn't fed anybody. He hasn't gone to the cross to save us. He hasn't preached any sermons. God says, "I love you," before you even start working, before you even produce any fruit. My love is there. Before we can do anything for God, please know that God already loves us. That God's love is not contingent upon our behavior or our perfection or our attitudes. That God's love just is. John says that God is love. And in Isaiah 42, "This servant is the one in whom God delights." Friends, God is with you. And God empowers you to do those hard things. That when we pray that prayer that says, "Lord, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors," I don't have the power within me to just be that magnanimous and forgiving, to say, "Okay, I forgive everybody who's ever wronged me." No, it's because God forgave me that then I can turn around and forgive someone else. It's through that act of receiving that gift of God's grace that I can then extend that grace of gift and love. It's like this water, this symbol that has washed me clean and fed me. Then I then can turn around and give somebody else a cup of cold water. That gift of grace and life, acceptance and freedom. That gift of God's unending love. We gave Star Words out last week, and if you didn't get one and you'd like one, we still have some in a basket at the back. The word that I got for this year is comfortable. No, it's not comfortable. It's daring. I was hoping for comfortable. I really wanted something that was like super fuzzy, touchy-feely, warm slippers kind of word. But that is not what I got because God has different things for me. He said, "I want you to be daring." And I said, "All right, Lord, I'm terrified. But I will dare greatly if you are with me. I will dare greatly if you are in me." That's that act of falling on our knees before we step out in faith to follow, to make sure that it's God's kingdom we are building. Friends, the next time you feel inadequate, remember that God is enough, that your baptism is enough, that God calls you into this life because of his work and his power and his grace. And together, with God by your side, you are enough. As we close our sermon this morning, I was struggling with, Lord, what are you calling us to do in the midst of the conflict and the chaos and the difficulty? And the words that kept ringing through my mind and in my spirit and in my head, the song that I kept singing was this version of the prayer of St. Francis. That he prays, "Lord, let me be an instrument of your peace. And where there's hatred, help me to bring love." That is what God calls us to. And so that's my prayer of blessing over us this morning. That God would make us a channel, an instrument, a conduit of his peace into the world. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there's despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith in you. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life.